Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
A very good morning to all of you. Praise God. Today God has got great and mighty plan for us. And this morning I was thinking, what to should I teach? And the Lord said, why don't you teach on God's medicine? What? God's medicine or God's prescription for our healing. Healing not only of the sickness in your body, but that healing is healing in your relationship, healing in your finance, healing in your marriage, healing in your children, the whole package of healing, inner healing, all kinds of healing, healing from fear, healing from depression, healing from stress, healing from everything. Is the topic good this morning?
Yes.
Praise God. Hallelujah. So let's pray to God and ask His help. Father, here we are in your presence. We thank you, we praise you. Lord, without your help, we can do nothing. We are gathered here, O Lord, in your name, Jesus, believing that you have got great and mighty plans for us, an expected end. Speak to us, Almighty God. We, your children, are here. We all have different issues, different questions, misunderstandings. Let your word, which is the truth, destroy every stronghold in our mind which is not of your kingdom. Let the truth break bondages and the lies of the devil, and let this truth help us to have a sure foundation, a strong foundation on your word, so that when the storm comes or flood comes or anything comes against us, the house will stand strong and not fall. So here we are, O Lord, with our hearts open to you. Spirit of God, enlighten our hearts and our mind, and teach us the secrets and the mysteries that are hidden from this world. And we are willing to respond, to submit, and to obey the instruction that you give us this morning. We thank you, we praise you. As you instruct us, Lord, you will also demonstrate your power and reveal to us your glory. The word that heals, the word that delivers, the word that prospers and protects us, the word that brings us into a close intimacy with you. So speak to us your word, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise God. So let's go to Proverbs chapter 4:20. Are you ready? Let's read it. My son, attend to my words. My son, what? Attend to my words. What's your Bible saying? Bell?
My son, be attentive to my
words. Okay, my son, be attentive to my words. Now, have you heard the word attentive before? Are we attentive, or when the children start moving, our attention is divided? Hello? Are we attentive? What's the meaning of the word attentive? You just changed from adjective to noun.
Fully?
Fully focus on God. Okay, something more, Mama? Sorry? Attentive is? Yeah, brother, tell me.
Concentrate.
Okay, let me give an example. A person is in the hospital, let's say the husband. The wife is in the same room looking after him. Is it possible? Yes. But we never say the wife attends to the husband, but we say the nurse attends to the patient. Is it right? But who spends more time with the husband in that room? The wife. The nurse only comes in different intervals. She just checks a little, gives him a little medicine and he goes. But we say she attends. Why is it that she attends and not the wife? Who spends more time? Who loves him more? But yet we say the nurse attends to the patient. Why? She is doing more significant than the wife is not doing? But the wife is not doing anything like that. She is not only doing it, whatever she has done, she also notes it on a report. Is that right? Mama, you are the nurse. You were the nurse. She is also a nurse. That's why she is still giving me the answer. Okay. Okay, as a nurse, let's say you gave the patient some injection. Do you put it on the report? What time? How much was the dose? Yes. And what was the diagnosis that you found, the pressure and all that? What about the wife? Does she have all the recordings? She is only looking at the husband and checking from the outside. But whereas the nurse uses instruments to go deep and check, and not only check, then notes it on the report. The nurse shift is over. The new nurse came. Does she know what you have done in the morning? She goes through that. And what about the doctor? Now, supposing the nurse had not to note and the nurse went, and the doctor will ask the wife, what was given to the husband? What will the wife say? Such and such medicine was given, this was given, that was given. She doesn't know anything. My husband was shivering at 10 o'clock. After that, the nurse came and poked him, and after 20 minutes he was normal. That's all she knows. What was given, does she know? So a nurse attends means she focuses extremely minutely in detail and records the details. Is that right? Now in the same way, God is saying, be attentive to my words or doctor's words? And we are attentive to whose words? See, many a time people say, I've got a very weak memory. I understand. But when the doctor says some sickness you have, he says it only once. But they can never forget what the doctor says. Do you know why? Because they are extremely attentive. Hallelujah. And not only that, they are so attentive, then they will go to Mr. Google and write that spelling and then search and research. Brother Archie, did you do that? Yeah. Now when you did that, you were extremely attentive to Google, whatever Mr. Google was saying. Did it build up your faith or did it tear you up? It didn't build your faith. So you did research for how long? 6 months. If you had to do that same research on the scriptures, what do you think would have happened? Hallelujah.
If you would have done the research on the word of God at that time, when he was just initial stages, his disease would have not progressed.
Because actually speaking, by making research on the sickness, the progress was very fast on the negative side.
Yeah, I saw that.
So now the Lord says, pay attention or be attentive to my words. So if anybody wants any kind of healing or anything, the first thing he says, where is your attention? Is your attention on the pain or on the word? You are from Bombay, right? You studied in Bombay? Yeah. We people in Bombay are very unique, right from childhood. When we do our homework, we do our homework with the TV on. Can you believe? We can watch TV and still do our homework. Nowhere in the world you will find children like that. Have you seen children any time looking at the TV program, cartoon, and doing their homework?
No.
Never?
Yes.
Huh? I'm asking, do they do yes or no?
Yes.
Now, when they are doing their homework was completed, no problem. But were they 100% attentive? In the same way, when we are reading the Bible, studying the Bible, are we 100% attentive or thinking about, oh, I have to wash my clothes? You know, when you are about to study the Bible, you will remember everything that you have to do. But when you are watching your favorite movie or favorite show, you don't remember anything. At that time, your attention is so much that even if somebody is calling, you can't even hear them. Are you understanding? So first thing he says, be attentive. Second, incline your ears to my, incline your ears to my saying. Incline, what is incline? What is incline? Pay attention, we finish. Incline. So you mean to say every time when you read the Bible you read this way? What is he saying? Incline your ears. Incline your ears. So every time you read the Bible, see that your ears are bent. Bent down. Is that what he says? He says, when you are attentive to my words, submit to my words. Agree to my words. Incline your ears means not your physical ears, your inner ears that are talking to you. A voice that is talking to you. See that you agree to my word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then let them not depart from your eyes. Let them not depart from your eyes. So what do? Write scriptures all over the wall so that you can see them, right? Why are you two laughing?
Because
you all did that. Okay. Is that what God is saying? So what is he saying? Keep them before your eyes. Let them not depart from your eyes. It should be all around you. Now my question to you is, you read a particular scripture in the morning. By afternoon an incident happened and your eyes are communicating to you. What your eyes are communicating to you, what it is seeing, is opposite to what you read. So which one is before your eyes now? So when he says keep them before your eyes means keep them before your spiritual eyes, your inner eyes, your imaginations, praise God, your visions that you make. Have you ever seen when we were small, nowadays children don't do that, but when we were small, we did not have gadgets to play. Come on. Okay, we used to sit in the class and the teacher would call out our name and we would be looking at the teacher, and she would ask a question and we would be blank. Do you know why? She would take a chalk and throw on us, and she would say, "Get up, you daydreamer." Huh? Has anybody ever experienced or seen some student having that? What was that person doing? Going deep in the thoughts, so deep that the person doesn't even know what's happening. Even when his name is called, he doesn't know. In the same way, the Lord is saying, the words that you have paid, the words that you have agreed and submitted, I want you to start imagining those words and make dreams, visions. And when you make those visions and dreams based on the word of God, let them not be erased or wiped out by the enemy. Don't let them depart. Keep them strong, because that is how faith works. Hello?
Yes.
Okay, I'll give you an incident that happened. There's this lady who used to come for my Bible class, and she was extremely efficient, very sincere, all the time do her homework well, and strong in a relationship with Jesus. Okay? It so happened that this lady one day got the news that she has got tumor in her stomach, and that too like a tennis ball. So when she heard that, and it is cancerous, what happened to her? Her heart broke down, and she began to weep. And the first thing that came to her mind is, my children are still in school. When she thought my children are still in school, what is she actually thinking? She's thinking about her death. Now, all the Bible study that she had done, did she keep that before her eyes, or the report before her eyes? You know, when you are on the computer, you open each window, okay? One will overlap the other one. Have you ever seen?
Yes.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now, which one did she keep in front?
No.
The latest one, the cancer.
Yeah.
What about 3 years of studying the Bible? That window was so much bright and open that she could not remember any of the scriptures or any of the promises. She was already preparing herself for the funeral. Praise God. She got so depressed that the others in the team began to go and talk to her and started having prayer service in her house twice a week. Within a week, she came out of what she was going through and she got into the world. Now, the chemo started, everything started, and she was extremely fair, like Suzanne. And when the chemo started, she became like me. Okay? And one day when I went, I was not staying in Bombay at that time. I came to Bombay and I saw her. And when she opened the door and I saw her, I broke down. But I could not show it before her eyes. So I quickly said, "Can I just use your washroom?" But before the tears could come, because she's such a wonderful lady. The tumor had actually brought so much of stress in her mind. So I went to the washroom and I stayed there, prayed, and after getting settled, I came out to see her. And I was praying, "Lord, now when I come out, she's going to ask me. She's going to ask me, 'Hey brother, listen, I have not done things like others do. I've been faithful in my marriage. I've been a good mother to my children. I've been studying the word of God for the last 4 years. I've been doing everything good. Then how come this tumor is killing me now?" And I said, "God, what will I say? give me something to say. So when I came, when I was inside, the Lord said, ask her to get a wedding album and I will tell you what to do. So when I came out, I said, sister, how many years you are married? She said, about 16 or 17 years married, okay. And then I said, can I have the wedding album? And she said, okay. And she brought a wedding album. And then I said, get the Bible and come. So she brought the Bible. And I said, come on, let's read the Bible and then let's look at the wedding album together. So open to Ephesians 3:20. That's where God began to teach me what to do. Open 3:20, Ephesians 3:20. Now we are studying, let them not depart before your eyes. What did God say? Let my word not depart before your eyes. Yeah, read.
Now,
say that now. Everybody say now.
Now.
Say that again.
Now.
Say that again.
Now.
Not tomorrow, now.
Now.
Now. Now to him, that is God,
who by the power,
so there is a power that is at work. That's good. Hey, that's good. There is a power that is sleeping or active? Active. Working where? In us or outside us?
Within
us. Within us.
Is able to
accomplish.
Abundantly.
Is able to accomplish abundantly. Far more than we can ask or
imagine.
Ask or
imagine.
Ask or
imagine.
Ask or
imagine.
So I said, what are you imagining? She said, I am studying the Bible, but at the same time, there are thoughts of fear of death. I said, did you ever have fear of cancer? She said, for a long time. I said, that imagination, that fear working in you is what got you into trouble. Now we can reverse it, because the Bible says, there is a power of God that is at work within us. There's a power of faith and there's a power of fear. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, the real challenge is, these children will be playing because they are small. But why are you playing with them? That's what we are studying. Be attentive to my words. Where's my attention? Incline your ears to my saying. Where are you submitting? To God's word or what's happening? Let them not depart from your eyes. What's before your eyes? The word or what they are doing? Praise God. These children over here are going to teach us practical, that you have to make up your mind. A decision. Even if these children are playing, Jesus loves them. But I'm not going to pay attention to what they are doing. I'm going to pay attention to what God's word is saying. Because these children are harmless. There are others who can distract us and lead us into bigger problems. Is it right? Come on.
Yes.
If we can get distracted by children, what about the other distractions? Praise God. So I told her, listen, the Bible says that what you are imagining, what you are asking, based on that, the power is going to work for you. So if you are thinking or asking is contradicting to God's word, you have deactivated God's power. and you have activated the power of worry, that which is fear. And the Bible says, fear comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus, who is love, from whom we get faith, he comes to give you life. So as long as I'm focused on the word and keeps this word in my imaginations, keeps this word before my eyes and do not allow it to depart from my eyes, not my natural eyes, my inner eye, my spiritual eye, even though there are many distractions, even though there are many threats, but I still keep my eyes fixed on Jesus, then the Bible says the power that is at work will work for you. And that power is love, that power is faith. But at the same time, I am worried and stressed. Now, the power of fear will destroy everything that God has given you. So I told her, let's open the Bible, let's open the album. And I said, look at your pictures over here. And she started crying. And I said, you know why you're crying? You're looking at that picture and you're looking at the color now, which has changed. And that is say, talking to you and saying, there's no chance. You look miserable. And your body will be more tortured and you are going to die. And that's the time I said, can you just change? Can you take these pictures from the album and other pictures that you have and stick them on your wall? Stick them in the washroom. Stick them in the washroom and keep those pictures, so that every time you are cooking, every time you are passing by, you look at those pictures and you are saying, God, I believe that the power that is at work within me is going to do all these things in my life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And she began her journey. And she did exactly that. And she would look at those pictures and laugh at what she would see in the mirror. And she would look at the picture. And she said, Lord, you said, if I can keep them before my eyes, praise God, your power is at work within me, not outside me, within me, and your power is going to bring forth the manifestation. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. She did it, I think, for 6 months, day and night. Today she is without cancer, her skin is restored, and now my SIM card which was there, I have given it to her, and she answers calls, and especially cancer calls, where she begins to share her testimony and the scriptures that she used to kill cancer. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So that's what he says, keep them before your eyes, let them not depart from your eyes, then keep them in the midst of your heart. Keep them in the midst of your heart. In your heart is the word of God. In your mind is what you see. Let me repeat that again. In your heart is the word of God. And in your mind is what you see. Now which one do we believe? In my heart is God saying, when a man and a woman get married, they are one flesh. Nothing, let nothing separate them. In my mind, I see my husband doesn't love me. My husband doesn't even call me. My husband has left me. My husband is gone and staying in some other place. Now all these things what I see speaks to my mind. At the same time, in my heart says, God has given me the power to speak to the mountain. I can speak to divorce. I can speak to separation. I can speak to hatred and bitterness. I can speak to unforgiveness. Because God has given me that power. Now, which one is in my heart? What is it that I keep in my heart? What God said or what my mind says? And as long as I keep what I can see with my mind, with my senses in my heart, I myself have stopped God's power to work for me. The battle in my life is not to get result. The battle in my life is to keep my heart, to keep in my heart the word of God. Hallelujah. Now, how do things enter my heart? What I see with my eyes enters my heart. What I hear with my ears enters my heart. When I use my feelings and emotions and I touch, enters my heart. And on the other side, the word of God that I study also enters my heart. So how do I use my five senses? The moment my senses are speaking something contradicting to the word of God, do I attack those thoughts and speak the word in my heart? Two, or do I sit in one place and I meditate about my troubles and my problems and now allow that to enter my heart? Because when faith walks in, fear goes out. When fear walks in, faith goes out. So who is going to walk into my heart is my own choice. I can open the door to fear, I can open the door to faith. Whichever door I open will enter my heart. Is that clear? And that's what the verse 22 says. If I've done these four things, paying attention to God, agreeing to God, keeping his word before my eyes, not allowing them to depart from my eyes, and fourth, being extremely vigilant for the word in my heart. If I do these four things, God says, for their life unto those who find them. The word of God is not bringing life to everybody. The word of God is bringing life only to those who find them. What's the meaning of the word find them? If I don't search, can I find? Now, am I finding a solution to my problem or the word of God? Hello? Am I searching for somebody to solve my problem or am I searching for the word of God? So, when I search for the word of God, who is supposed to get me out of trouble? The word of God is supposed to get me out of trouble. And who is this word? The Lord Jesus. So are we feeding our spirit with the word? Or are we just telling Jesus, Lord, please get me out of this trouble? He is saying, listen, I and my word are the same. How do I know that you love me? I will only know that you love me when you spend your time with my word. When you make my word the highest place in your life. When your life is governed by my word and not by your emotions. That's the time I will know that you truly love me. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So write down. Okay, I did not finish. For their life unto those that find them, and health, say that health, good health to all their flesh. Now, does anybody want good health in their body, in their finances, in their marriage, in their children, in their feelings and emotions? good health in every area. So will everybody who come to church get this good health?
No.
All those who came today, will we all get good health?
No.
Come on.
Yes.
Come on, yes or no?
Yes.
No. Only to those who find them. Only those who are attentive. Only those who are agreeing to His word. Only those who are forgetting their problem or keeping their problems aside and magnifying the word of God. Only those who have the word in their heart, they speak out of their mouth, they act on the word that is in their heart. These are the ones who will find healing to all their flesh. Amen. Was the prescription good?
Yes.
What about a person taking the Bible and keeping it under the pillow? Have you ever seen any person taking the doctor's medicine, keeping in the pocket, and every time the doctor said one in the morning, one in the afternoon, after lunch, and one after dinner? So he takes the pocket after lunch and puts that back. In the evening, takes that packet and puts it back, and he has been doing that for 15 days, and then he goes to the doctor for the test report, and the doctor says, I don't understand, the medicine is not working. In fact, your case has become much worse than before. Did you take the medicine? Yes, yes doctor, I've been taking regularly. When are you taking? Morning, afternoon, and evening, after dinner. Okay, how do you take? Will it work? Write down. Attend to God's word. Attend to God's word for healing. For healing. By following God's prescription. By following God's prescription. God's will is to heal. God's will to heal is found all through the world. God's will to heal is found all through the world, all through His word. It is God's will to heal everyone. It is God's will to heal everyone. You have faith in God's word. If you have faith in God's word, if you have faith in Him, if you have faith in Him, which one do you have? Do you have faith in Jesus? Or do you have faith in His word? Hey. You have faith in Jesus or you have faith in His word? Which one? I am asking you a simple question. You have faith in Jesus or you have faith in the word of God? Yeah, my sister. I am asking a simple question. I am not asking explanation. Just a simple question. You have faith in Jesus or you have faith in the word of God? You have faith in Jesus. How many of you have faith in Jesus? Lift your hands up. Good, quite a lot. Very good. How many of you have faith in the word of God? Some of them put both the times hands. You say, sir, I'm going to ask you again. How many of you have faith in Jesus? Hallelujah. So remember, having faith in Jesus and having faith in His word is one and the same. So, if we really believe, I'm talking about not the oral test that you gave, the answer is right. If we really believe, then most of the time with whom are you going to spend? How many of you want to spend, sit and have a chat with Jesus? Nobody. Come on, everybody wants to have a chat with Jesus. How do you have a chat with Jesus? By studying His word, because He is Jesus. But if we really believe, then every moment that I have, what am I doing? Chatting with Him, His love letter to me, reading His love letter over and over again. The Bible. Hallelujah. Look at the 23rd verse. Keep thy heart with all diligence. Put a guard on your heart. Be vigilant. Yeah, everybody wants to know how the such children are going to walk and where is this lady walking out. Everybody wants to see. Please tell us and tell, go, where are you going? Because now everybody, most of them are saying, she went, God, I think she went here, she went there. It has become a habit to fill our mind with things that are unwanted and things which are essential. We are busy. Praise the Lord. Yeah, read the 23rd verse.
Keep your heart with all diligence.
Keep your heart with all diligence. Yeah, diligence then. So from it flows the issues of life. So if anybody springs or issues of life, okay. Now, if anybody wants to know his future, is it simple? God says, what you have stored in your heart is what is the future that you are going to experience. So if your heart is full of hurts, what are you going to experience in your life? Your heart is full of revenge, what are you going to feel? So what kind of things are in our heart? I'm talking about relationships. So is it important for us to keep our heart under extreme vigilance? But the Bible clearly says, because what's in your heart is what you will see your future. And if your heart is loaded every day with scriptures, no matter how many battles come, you are always victorious. Praise God. Write down, you have faith in God's word. You have faith in God's word. You have faith in God's word. If you have faith in Him, if you have faith in Him, they are one and the same. Yeah. Can you sit down? I can't hear you. Can you come? I like you asking me questions or what we are studying. Yeah, you can ask me questions on what I'm teaching. Others will go off topic somewhere else. Yeah, go ahead, ask me questions.
How can I control what is in my heart?
How can I
control what is in my heart?
How can I
control what is in my heart?
How can I control?
You said that our heart, what's in our heart, is very, very important.
Yes.
Is there a way I can control?
Come here, Baba. Now, when I told you come here, did you come?
Yes, I did.
So, did you hear my words and agree to my word?
Yes.
In the same way, God is giving us some instructions.
Yes.
Am I studying those instructions? Now, when we came to this St. Peter's Church, we did not even know that this place existed. Because I'm not from here. But the man in the cab asked me postcode number, and I knew the postcode number in my heart. So all that I did was what? Give the postcode. So now that the postcode is given, will the lady in the GPS tell me where to take right and where to take left?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now if I follow her, will I reach here?
Yes.
Yes. In the same way, when you have your desire from the word of God, He will give you the instruction what to do. Rejoice in the Lord. Always give thanks to God in all situations. Now these are the instructions that God gives us. But do we follow them?
Okay, so the following our hearts is following God's instruction.
Yeah. Not yet over. See, there are many people saying the troubles in my life is not getting over. I'm going through this trouble and it's not getting over. Now we know that in UK there are different seasons. What's the season now?
Summer.
Okay. After that will come what? Summer again. After that will come what? Summer again. What will come? Autumn. Then will come what? Winter. After that? Spring. And then? So it's a cycle. Why is it acting this way? Because the earth and the moon, the earth and the sun, they are under God's instructions. God is the one who created, right? If they start disobeying God's instruction, what do you think will happen? So in the same way, God is saying, if you want your season to change, follow my instruction. Your season will change in no time. But what are we praying? God, please get me out of this trouble, but don't tell me to follow your instruction. And I would ask Jesus, can you give me an example which will be easy to understand? So He gave me an example. A person for 5 years has been preparing coffee and putting a white powder in it, stirring it, and when it's tasting, it is always salty. So what has he been putting?
Salt.
Very good, you are smart. Now, one day a person teaches him and gives him a fresh powder and he says, put this, and he stirs it and it is sweet. What was the powder?
Sugar.
Now which one is easy, to follow the old habit or to grow in a new habit? Which one is easy? Old habit is easy. So he goes home and again he is putting which powder? So what is he getting? And then he's praying, God, I went for the retreat. I have sincerely prayed, but my coffee is still salty. What is God saying? You went for the retreat, there you were taught, stop putting salt and start putting sugar. your coffee will become sweet. Has the season of saltiness changed? My brother, yeah? How much do you want? How desperate are you to change your situation?
Very desperate.
Then you are very desperate to follow his instruction. And if you are very desperate to follow his instruction, then you will always come to the retreat with a notebook and a pen and a Bible. The very reason that you came without a pen and a book and a Bible is because you are not serious about the instruction. Nobody liked it. But that's the evidence. Because if I have not come with a book, my other message to the preacher is, whatever you say, I can remember everything. And even in school, there were some students who never took their notebook because they would remember everything that the teacher taught, and on the day of exam, they could write it everything. Or you had a homework book and a classwork book. You all had? So this is a school of the Holy Spirit. And the teacher is the Holy Spirit who is teaching us and saying, you want your season to change? Simple. Whatever instructions you are hearing, put them into practice. And things will change. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Write down. Attend to God's word for healing. Attend to God's word for healing. It means put it first. Put it first. What put it first? First. Put it first means what? Put God's word. Hello, put God's word. Now, whenever you meet people, what do they speak out of their mouth? God's word or their problems? Now, let's say you came in the morning with your problems. You heard God giving you instruction. During the break, what will you come and speak? Agnello, what did you say? So, have you put God's word first or your problems first? So what's in your mind? What are you attentive of? Will the season change?
No.
Hello, will the season change?
No.
Write down. Let these words not depart. Two. Let these words not depart. Let them not get away from you. Let them not get away from you. Pay undivided attention. Pay undivided attention. You remember the child studying and doing the homework and watching TV. So pay undivided attention. Do we have divided attentions?
Yes.
So, as long as that is there, Steffi, can things change in your life? So, where's the problem? The problem is with the other people or with you. Your undivided attention is stopping God from intervening in your situation. So from now on, your battle is to get result or to get focused that I should not have undivided attention. Focused on what? Undivided attention. Or focused on the result. So if when I have got undivided attention, that becomes the root. And if the root is right, the fruit will come at maturity. Hallelujah. Write down. These words of God, just the next paragraph. These words of God are life. And not condemnation. God's life destroys sin and death.